Thank you, Todd and Abel and Dean Keesling for that prelude, as well as the pre-service music. Very fortunate here to have great musicians and people who have friends that are great musicians, okay? And willing to tear out something in this house, too. I think you did that. So, my name is Eric Evans, and welcome to the worship services this morning here at First United Methodist Church. If you're a guest with us, and maybe it's the first time you've been with us, or maybe it's been a long time since you've been with us, and we'd love to know that you're here today. Inside your bulletin here, I've got a theater moment going on. Inside your bulletin is a perforated section that has some questions there we'd love for you to fill out for us. And we are not passing our offering plates right now. We are having them available in the narthex or the foyer area. So if you have an offering or you have a guest card to put in there, that's the place to put that. The ushers can help lead you and guide you in doing that. Also, if you're online with us, we'd like to say a big welcome to you as well. You can text information to us. Information is located there on the Facebook page as well as our YouTube page. We'd love to have you ask information, ask questions, do all that. The pastors here will help fill those things in as we walk the walk on the online presence of the First United Methodist Church. So just make yourself aware of those particular components. Inside the bulletin, and just to make you aware, we continue to have some things that are opening up and beginning to start and have taken a place. And so there's a schedule inside there that says upcoming events. There's also some information about some things that are taking place right now with an insert. The prayer shawl ministry here at the church is getting going again. There's also some Bible study opportunities if you have an interest in. If you're a college student or you know somebody who is a college student that fits that particular demographic, there are opportunities for them here at the church and on campus as well. So all of that being said, I encourage you to do just that. Well, I think we're ready for the affirmation of faith that's going to be led today by Priscilla Munson. Let's all stand together as we begin our worship time.
Good morning, church. Join with me in affirming what we believe. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Please remain standing. You can take your hymn books and turn to page number 73. It'll also be on the screen. We're going to be singing that first and last verse of O Worship the King this morning.
O worship the King, O glorious above, O gratefully sing God's power and God's love, our shield and defender, the Ancient of Days, pavilioned in splendor and girded with praise. Frail children of dust and feeble as frail, in thee do we trust, nor find thee to fail. Thy mercies how tender, how firm to the end, our Maker, Defender, Redeemer, and Friend.
You may be seated.
Our reading this morning comes from Psalm 121. It's found on page 844 in your hymnal or is on the screen as you prefer. I lift my eyes to the hills. From whence does my help come? My help comes from the Lord who made heaven and earth. The Lord will not let your foot be moved. The Lord who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, the one who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade on your right hand. The sun shall not smite you by day, nor the moon by light. The Lord will keep you from all evil and will keep your life. The Lord will keep your going out and your coming in this time forth and forevermore. Thanks be to God.
I invite you to open your hymns or look towards the screens. Turn into page number 128. Page 128, we're going to sing that first and fourth verse of He Leadeth Me, O Blessed Thought.
He leadeth me, O blessed thought, O words with heavenly comfort fraught. Whate'er I do, where'er I be, still 'tis God's hand that leadeth me. He leadeth me, He leadeth me, by His own hand He leadeth me. His faithful follower I would be, for by His hand He leadeth me. And when my task on earth is done, when by Thy grace the victory's won, in death's cold wave I will not flee, since God through Jordan leadeth me. He leadeth me, He leadeth me, by His own hand He leadeth me. His faithful follower I would be, for by His hand He leadeth me.
Well, good morning. I'm honored to be with you today. I know that some things have changed since I was last in the traditional service, one of which is that we're live streaming the service. So I certainly want to add to Eric's welcome to welcome those who are streaming at home. And we would hope that this worship experience will be just as meaningful to you from your kitchen table as it is from here in the sanctuary. So we bless you and thank you for tuning in. And I want to thank all of you who are here in the sanctuary today, as we are all learning in this unprecedented season the habits that we need to practice to keep everyone healthy and safe. But thank you for attention to those protocols that we have in place. Now would you bow with me for a word of prayer. Father, we ask that we would know your grace today. We are so grateful for the privilege that is ours to call you Father, for the work that you've done through Jesus on the cross to make us a family. We ask your blessings upon all of our church family. For all of those listed as prayer needs, we ask for your healing grace to be upon their lives. We're thankful so much for the privilege that we have to be together here today, and we trust that in this time that you would refresh us, that you would strengthen us, that you would speak to us, that you would encourage us, and we would leave stronger. And now we pray together as you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Joey's message this morning, we've asked Jill Underwood, who has also been filling in today on the organ for us, to come and sing I'd Rather Have Jesus.
I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather be his than have riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than houses or lands. I'd rather be led by his nail-pierced hands than to be the king of a vast domain or be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today. I'd rather have Jesus than man's applause. I'd rather be faithful to his dear cause. I'd rather have Jesus than worldwide fame. I'd rather be true to his holy name than to be today.
Thank you, Jill. Well, I'm very delighted to be with you today. I always wish for more opportunities to be in this service, but our church structured it as it is, that it is as it is. But I'm so glad to be here with you and to share in a few moments in a series that I've been doing in the Gospel of John. For the past several weeks, we've taken a look at stories in the Gospel of John, but rather than read them perhaps in the way we would normally would, we took a hard look at, in the first message, the prologue that is the first 18 verses of John's Gospel. It's a poetic piece of writing, you may be familiar with it, and it's very theological. And in that writing, John does what I would call establishes a lens by which he wants us to view his gospel. He doesn't want you to come to the story of the woman at the well or the story, you know, of the woman caught in adultery and other stories and just view it in sort of a haphazard way. He gives you a framework by which he wants to do that. So as we turn our attention to the story today of a blind man who was healed by Jesus, we come to the idea of that the same way. One of the texts that is true that John mentions in his prologue that you will see lived out in this story of Jesus healing this man blind from birth is this verse from chapter 1. In him was life, and the life was the light of all people, and the light shines in darkness. You will see in this story the images of light and darkness. So be looking for that. The second one is this. There's a verse in that prologue also that says this. He came to his own, but his own did not receive him. But to those who did receive them, he gave the right to become children of God. You're going to see his own, the Pharisees, the Jews, reject him, but a man who did not know him at all come to become one of God's people. So I want to remind you today, as we begin this story, that one of the foundations, one of the critical elements of spiritual life is how we see things. Seeing for the believer is spiritual. And I'm not talking about physical sight, but spiritual sight. And it's not so much how we see or what we see, but it's the heart that's behind how we see the things that God puts in front of us. I believe that our relationship with God should impact at every level how we see others and how we view the world. God's people are to be those who see what others don't see. And good spiritual vision is critical to our faith. We are even asked by the Lord Jesus to see ourselves differently than what we would had we not been forgiven and known his grace. But because we've experienced the unconditional love of God, his love has forever altered even our view of ourselves. So as we listen to these scriptures, I want you to think about those ideas of light and darkness, the idea of vision, and the idea of people rejecting him and receiving him, and see what you see in this today. So we come today to the story of the blind man, and in the greatest of ironies, ends up being the one who sees things better than anybody else in the story. For it seems to me that it's not just his eyes that were open, but that his whole being was made whole. And he's the one that sees better than anybody. So let's take a look at our scripture. If you're in the Pew Bible, it's page 96. It's John chapter 9, beginning with verse 1. So as we read and interact with this text, let's kind of have those things in mind. And here's the story. As he walked along, he saw a man blind from birth, and his disciples asked him, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" And Jesus answered, "Neither this man nor his parents sinned. He was born blind so that God's work might be revealed in him. We must work the works of him who sent me while it is day, for night is coming when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world." And when he had said this, he spat on the ground and made mud with the saliva and spread the mud on the man's eyes, saying to him, "Go wash in the pool of Siloam," which means sent. Then he went and washed, and he came back and was able to see. The neighbors and those who had seen him before as a beggar began to ask, "Is this not the man who used to sit and beg?" Some were saying, "It is he." Others were saying, "No, but it is someone like him." And he kept saying, "I am the man." But they kept asking him, "Then how were your eyes open?" And he said, "The man called Jesus made mud. He spread it on my eyes and said to me, 'Go to Siloam and wash.' Then I went and washed and received my sight." And they said to him, "Where is he?" And he said, "I do not know." Verse 13. They brought to the Pharisees the man who had been formerly blind. And now it was a Sabbath day when Jesus made the mud and opened his eyes. Then the Pharisees also began to ask him how he had received his sight. And he said to them, "He put mud on my eyes, then I washed, and now I see." Some of the Pharisees says, "This man is not from God, for he does not observe the Sabbath." But others said, "How can a man who is a sinner perform such signs?" And they were divided. And they said again to the blind man, "What do you say about him? It was your eyes that he opened." And he said, "He is a prophet." Now we skip down to verse 24. So for the second time, they called the man who had been blind, and they said to him, "Give glory to God, for we know that this man is a sinner." And he answered, "I do not know whether he is a sinner or not. One thing I do know, though I was blind, now I see." And they said to him, "What did he do to you? How did he open your eyes?" And he answered them, "I have told you already, and you would not listen. Why do you want to hear it again? Do you also want to become his disciples?" Then they reviled him, saying, You are his disciple, but we are disciples of Moses, for we know that God has spoken to Moses. But as for this man, we do not know where he comes from. And the man answered, here is an astonishing thing. You do not know where he comes from, and yet he opened my eyes. We know that God does not listen to sinners, but he listens to the one who worships him and obeys his will. Never since the world began has it been heard that anyone opened the eyes of a person born blind. If this man were not from God, he could do nothing. And they answered him, you were born entirely in sins, and are you trying to teach us? And they drove him out. Jesus heard that they had driven him out, and when he found him, he said, do you believe in the Son of Man? And he said, who is he, sir? Tell me, so that I may believe in him. And Jesus said to him, you have seen him, and the one speaking with you is he. And he said, Lord, I believe. And he worshiped him. Will you pray with me? Lord, we pray today as we read this story and consider your word, that you also would open our eyes. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. This is a great story. I think this is one of the great stories of the New Testament. It has several layers, several scenes, you know, the scene with the crowd, the scene with Jesus in the street, twice in the temple, and then Jesus finds him alone. And I find it to be sort of an intriguing story in many ways. I am fascinated at a certain level how a man who had had no other position in life than to be a blind beggar sitting in the streets would be the one in this situation who would summon the courage to be so fearless before the Pharisees. There's much to consider, I think, about this story. So I want to share with you and focus on the details, I think, that would most help us today. Let me begin by saying this. The story starts with this quote. His disciples said to him, who sinned, this man or his parents? Who sinned that he should be blind? I want to say to you today that I've lived long enough to know this is true, that sometimes no one is to blame. In the human experience, we want to blame somebody. An accident happens. Let's sue the company. This happens. We always want, it seems like, to hold somebody responsible. If something goes wrong, somebody has to blame. You know, somebody has to be held accountable. But I think that there is a certain sense in which you listen to Jesus. He's saying neither this man nor his parents sinned. It is like this so that God can be glorified in his blindness. I want to remind you today that some things just happen in life. There's nobody at fault. We live on a fallen planet, in a broken world. I think it would be easier sometimes if some of the more difficult problems we could find exactly who is to blame and call them out on it. But sometimes somebody is not to blame. I was reminded as I was reading that text, who is to blame? This man's blind. Somebody did something wrong. That's the text and tenor of it, right? I was reminded of this phrase, generational curse. Sometimes we got to remember that the person standing in front of us fighting an addiction, fighting a temper, fighting the inability to manage their finances, fighting and fighting and fighting just to sort of sustain life, that sometimes what they're facing, what they're dealing with, is stuff that comes from generations prior. It's not an easy thing. It's the consequence of an ancestor's actions, beliefs, or sins that have been passed down. And so I think for God's people, for us, when somebody says, who's to blame, that we ought to be more given to the energy that it takes to solve the problem rather than to figure out whose fault it is. And so we come to that like that with Jesus. Secondly, this, how we see others is impacted by the presence of Jesus. I found it interesting that when I was reading the story multiple times that you start reading it and you see these people that are like, we can't believe this guy who's all of our lives, he's been right here begging and blind since he was born, and now he can see. And it says this, the neighbors and those who had seen him before as a beggar. And some of them said, yeah, that's the guy. And some said, no, it's somebody like him. They were arguing over whether or not it was the guy. Here's one of our problems that we face, and this is the place where the gospel ought to mean the most to God's people. We tend to see people and evaluate them by how we knew them before rather than how bad they are now. The gospel always should be willing to give people a fresh start. But there's a real debate, right? No, it's not him. Some like him. But I think the biggest favor that we can do for others sometimes is to see them for who they are now and release them from what they used to be. That's when you say amen, it's okay. Amen? But here's the problem. We live in a small town. I always used to say about living in Brownwood, I grew up in a town smaller than this, but I always used to say if you're standing in Kroger or Walmart and somebody asks you about something and it's somebody you don't like or you had cross words with last week, you better be careful what you say about them because you're probably talking to their cousin. We know everybody's business. Joe Johnson has an affair. Everybody in town knows who the affair was with, how long it lasted, when it started, how it ended. Right? And then we evaluate them for their faults, for their weaknesses, for their weakest day, for their failures, for their sins. And somehow we've got to see people for who they are now and not see them for who they were before. In fact, I think the spirit of the gospel, the spirit of the gospel, the true spirit of the good news is to expect and embrace radical change in people's lives at the hand of Jesus. In fact, if this is not true, we should close the doors and not have church again. Jesus comes to radically change people's lives. And I don't know about you, but I shudder to think where I would be were it not for the people in all the churches I've been in my life. All the youth workers who were teaching Sunday school and having us over their house for Bible studies and taking us to camps and retreats growing up. And then, I mean, all the places I've lived in different churches where people brought to my life a deposit of the grace and goodness of God because they loved me simply because I was their brother in Christ. I shudder to think of that. And we want to welcome people who are radically changed and see them in the newness of who they are. But one of the problems that these guys were facing, and one of the problems that the Pharisees were facing, this is not a big point, but I want to mention it, it's that how seems to be more important than why. They want to know, how did you get healed? They kept asking him, how did this happen? What did he do? How? How? And he's kind of like, look, I don't know what you're talking about. All I know is I was blind, and now I see. Who cares how? This guy could have been showing up in a Bozo the Clown outfit. If he healed me, I'm healed. What does it matter, right? I mean, I am healed. Listen, the mechanics of the healing seem to be more important to this group of people than why he was healed or the heart of God that reached out and touched him. And they hardly even bothered to ask him, how do you feel about it? They just kept asking him how. So sometimes we need to not get hung up on the how. Hello? Do I need to stop? Okay. We don't need to talk about how the sound system works at this point. And then I love this. The blind man ends up being the one who sees the situation clearer than anyone else. Isn't that the great irony of the situation? Who would have thought that a blind beggar would have more boldness and insight into what needed to be said to the Pharisees than anybody else in the situation? Think about it. I just tried to imagine. Born blind, spent his entire life. He's probably at least in his 20s, we would think, because his parents get called and he's grown now. So his life had been diminished, and he had to have had some sense of a diminished self. He had to be beat down, right, to be a blind beggar, dependent on other people just to be able to have food to eat. Of everyone there, he should not have been the one who felt like he could speak up, but he's the one that spoke up. And it reminds me of this truth, that the gospel tells us that Jesus has a heart for those who somehow don't fit, those who are on the fringe of society, those who are the marginalized. Jesus, if he were to come to Brownwood today, would not make an appointment with the city council or Mayor Haynes. He would be in the back corners of the streets talking to people who are down and out, having a tough time. That's who he'd be talking to. This is the Jesus that I love. That's why last week when I preached the woman caught in adultery, the week before that, the woman at the well, there are these stories, right, that John writes in his Gospels that reminds us that Jesus came to have one-on-one conversations with people who probably didn't feel like they had any right to even be talking to someone like that. And there he stood, talking to them, honoring them. Let's be a people who stay convinced, even today, that people like this in our community are on the radar of Jesus the Christ. And he walks among us. Wouldn't you like to be a part of people's lives being so radically changed that after it's changed, we would have to argue whether or not it's even the same person? I remind us today that the impact of the gospel message upon the lost soul is radical. That God looks at people who have never stepped their foot in church, who curse, who have no sense of what it means to know the Lord, and His heart breaks for them. It is the image Jesus gave us. If you had 100 sheep, if you had 99 of them at home and one was lost, you would leave the 99 and go find the one. It's exactly like that. And He looks at those and He calls those things that be not as though they already were. And I think it's interesting in this story. The more I read it, the more I realized that what this man said in each of these scenes changes a little bit. The first time they say to him, "How did you get healed?" He says, "The man called Jesus." He just knew his name. He's just a man, and they called him Jesus. "He put mud on my eyes, and I washed in the pool." The second time they asked him, he said, "He's a prophet." The third time they asked him, he said, "He's from God." And then the last time, when Jesus comes to meet him, what does he say? "You are the Son of God, the Son of Man." It's a progression. It reminds me of this reality, that one of the things we've got to keep in mind when we've been in church for a long, long time, that to walk in the doors of a church when you don't have a church background is a frightening experience. And we don't need people to walk in the doors having figured everything out already. Are you with me? We want them to come to, right? Don't we welcome people in our Bible studies and small groups and Sunday school classes? You don't have to know everything, have everything figured out. No, I mean, I can't find Malachi in my Bible still sometimes, right? We don't have to know all that. We will take people who come to Him in stages. You don't have to understand it all at once. And so in conclusion, I want to end with what I believe is a beautiful picture of the gospel message. I remind you that to be thrown out of the temple is not like, "Hey, don't come to church today." It was a different experience in that culture. They threw him out of the temple, which probably meant he wasn't welcome anymore, which meant he was, you know, disconnected from God. He was disconnected from the law, disconnected from all things spiritual. You're shunned from the temple. They threw him out. And the reason he got thrown out is because Jesus healed him. It's kind of Jesus' fault a little bit. But what happens, right? They throw him out of the temple, and here's what the scripture says. "And Jesus heard that they had driven him out, and when he found him." So what does that mean? When he heard that they had thrown him out, he went looking for him. Isn't that a great picture? He went looking for him. One guy, he's busy. Jesus got a lot on his plate. He's busy. But he goes looking for this one man until he finds him. And then he introduces him in this progression of his faith that had taken probably over just hours or days, really, for him to come to this place. And he comes to know that Jesus is the Son of Man. I remind you today, in our times of rejection, when we feel like we've been thrown out of something, when we're facing that kind of rejection, that Jesus is the Savior that will come and find you. And as we end today, I want to tell you this. What are some things you can take away from today's message? Number one, the gospel changes people's lives. We are in the people-changing business. I have a friend that on their website, their mission statement for their church, it just says this: "Changed lives, period." That's their mission statement. We want to see people's lives changed because of the gospel of Christ. Secondly, it's okay to experience faith in a progression. We don't need people to walk in the doors having everything figured out. It's okay, especially in our church, I think it's okay to come and be figuring things out, be understanding Scripture and God. You don't even have to have faith yet. You can be coming and asking questions. It's okay to ask questions. And lastly, this: the message of Jesus should clearly impact how God's people see others. It's not what we understand. It's not how we feel. Oftentimes, it's how we see. Will you pray with me? Lord Jesus, we thank you that this story tells us that you see us individually, that you'll come and find us when we need you, that you'll speak truth to us, that you'll bring healing to us. Thank you for the message of the gospel. Let it reside in our hearts, that we as your people would share it with others in every way that we can. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
I invite you to join with us in our closing hymn this morning. In your hymn books, it's page number 156. Page 156, "I Love to Tell the Story." We'll sing that first and last verse. Let's all stand together.
Please bow for our benediction. Father, we pray that the grace of Jesus Christ would live in our hearts. We ask you to bless our church family, that you would increase our strength and encourage us in this season. Bless us as we go. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.